for us. So everybody, this is my precious friend, Nadiya Saha. Did I say it right?
Shah.
Yeah. Nadiya Shah.
Yes.
And I met her many years ago at SOTA, and we love each other. So I'm going to try to stay on topic here. And
we're going to try to be professional here.
That's right.
Don't know how well we'll be able to do it, but we will try, yes. But yes, I met you way back in 2006 when I went to SOTA, the SOTA conference. That was my very first astrology conference, period. And you were the very first person I talked to in the sort of lounge hallway area.
I remember so clearly, yeah. Walking in, and there was something about your face that said, I'm lost.
Yeah, I was. I was lost. I was scared. I was like, oh my God, what is this going to be like? And there was fear, actually. I think, especially in the beginning, that sense of, do I belong here? And am I really an astrologer? And, you know, am I good enough to be an astrologer? That, you know, stupid first house Saturn in my chart, all of that kicking up for me. But you were home, right? You were home. So you were the first signal, I guess, that this was going to be home for me. And astrology and the astrology world and astrology conferences, certainly, all of that is where I feel most at home. And you started it all off for me. So thank you.
I'm so lucky that I got to be that for you, because you have been so extraordinarily successful. And as I recall, you were just graduated from Kepler, were you not?
No, I actually, at the time when I met you, I was in my last year of university as an undergrad. And, you know, it's so interesting because SOTA, that's where we met the illustrious and unforgettable Donna Van Toen, who was the goddess of that conference. I remember being in the, like, sort of the trade room, and there was a networking table, and she saw me and she smiled at me, and we started talking. And while she was standing there talking, I remember looking down, and there was pamphlets there for MA programs. And I remember seeing the pamphlet for the MA program for the University of Kent in England, and something in me said, I gotta go there. That's where I need to be. And literally the following academic year, I was off to England, and that's where I did my astrology themed MA.
So what is your precise degree?
It's a master's in cultural cosmology and divination. That's what it's called. Yes, that's the fancy title.
Now, I think most people know you from your YouTube because you were the very first person I found on YouTube when I finally learned what YouTube was.
Yeah.
As an old schooler. And I was like, I'm going to find some astrology. Nadiya is here.
I know, right?
Back then,
I've been on YouTube since 2008. 2008, back then, there were very few astrologers who were on YouTube. We kind of knew who was on YouTube. It was literally just a handful, a small number. And it's been so wonderful to see how YouTube has become a force for astrology and astrologers. It's been this incredible force to empower astrologers. Right now, I'm teaching a course with Kepler, and it's amazing. The course sold out. Because there is this awareness among astrologers that it is through YouTube that we're able not just to reach people, not just to demonstrate our skills, but also to actually be ambassadors of astrology in some way. And it's a powerful, beautiful blessing, YouTube is. It allowed me to empower myself, that's for sure.
Sure. And you also write, because I happen to own two of your books. And you must also read for people, right?
Yeah, of course. I have a limited clientele that I do continue on with. I have my books, right? I've got a whole bunch of books here. I was preparing for being here with you. These are three. I have four. I love you. Yes, I have four books altogether that I've written. I love writing books. Like, books to me are immortal. Like, that really is something that means so much to me, that one day, 200 years from now, 500 years from now, someone can say, like, oh, wow, I have this person in my ancestry who wrote these books. There's something about contributing to the canon, the the astrological canon that is very meaningful to me. So I love writing books. I love having written books as well. And I remember, like for me, when I did my MA, I wrote my dissertation on the work of Ibn Arabi. And Ibn Arabi was an 11th century Sufi mystic and a philosopher and an astrologer. And to me, that, and coming across his work was so deeply meaningful to me on so many levels. And I ended up writing my dissertation on his work as well. And that is another understanding I had that, wow, I could read one of his books and feel my life change by reading his book. I want to be able to do that for somebody 1,000 years from now, 500 years from now.
So that's Aquarian of you.
I know, isn't it? Isn't it so Aquarian of me?
Gift to humanity.
Yes, my gift to humanity is my books. And then I have other things I do as well, right? I have my own school called Synchronicity University where I teach online. Before the pandemic, I was traveling all over the world and teaching as well. And I have a membership, an exclusive membership on my website called Superstar. So there's so many different things and ways in which I get to be an astrologer in the world, you know, and that's such a blessing. To have the trust of people is such a blessing.
Well, how many times have you spoken at this conference, at Breaking Down the Borders?
This is my first time with Breaking Down the Borders. Can you believe it? I'm so excited.
Well, I hope you know that we were the first online conference.
Wow, that's amazing.
Thank goodness that we broke the ice on that one. Oh, it's been, this is five. This is number five. And we don't do them every year. So, I mean, it's been, I'm sure it's been 8 years since the first one.
Well, talk about Aquarian. There must be some signature in there that has to do with participating in the future, because it is now, obviously, the future.
Obviously.
Saturn and Aquarius. Yeah. I mean, come on.
But we all are. Also, Ina, that's the international. It was OCA when I graduated from Astro College, but it's now International Academy of Astrology, IAA. And she had the foresight to open a school online, also the first.
So, yeah. Well, she's brilliant. I mean, she's such a force in astrology.
She's
so.
All Gemini.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
She does have an Aquarius moon, so you're right.
Yeah.
So it came from somewhere. But the fun thing about it is, and I think that, you know, they're evolving. What we did and what we're doing now is an evolutionary process of what, where we started, and everybody gets to sort of jump off of us. But we do this thing called a foyer so that the speakers can come and be in a room where they can talk to the attendees or really anybody who's at the conference who wants to stop by and chat. So I really hope you'll do that. Usually I host it. I may not this year, I don't know, but you know,
drop by, that'll be fun.
And then you get to, people can ask you questions in real time. So your talk is an introduction to astrological
yes.
magic, which is a very hot topic.
Yes, and a topic very near and dear to my heart.
Ibn Ezra, did I say it right? You said it
what?
Differently. Ibn Ezra, is that?
Oh, I said Ibn Arabi.
Ibn Arabi.
Yeah, so I, well, look, my book Prayers to the Sky is sort of a summation. It has a lot of what we're going to be talking about in the class. But what I do is I go through the development, historical and philosophical development. I have a Sag moon and an Aquarius sun. I can be quite the nerd. So this is going to be my nerdy self shining, talking about Plato, talking about Plotinus. We're going to talk about Ibn Arabi, the Picatrix, and Agrippa's books on occult philosophy. So we are going to go through an understanding of how astrological magic has been understood from a philosophical place, a historical place as well. But I'm always very interested in what are we actually doing? Why are we doing it, right? Instead of just focusing on the doing itself, which has its value, which is part of what Prayers to the Sky is based on. It actually has things like prayers and suggestions as to astrological timing. And we'll have some of that in the talk. But I love looking at what did Plato believe? How did he understand the world around him, the planets, how they are lit up with spiritual energy, how we're connected to that. Because I think when you understand that, you're able to actually practice astrological magic, not only that much more meaningfully, but probably more effectively as well. You're able to practice it if you feel so inspired to. But astrological magic is something very near and dear to my heart. It's something that I've been practicing or studying or diving into in some way or another for at least 2 decades now. So it's such
really
a thrill.
Risen to the forefront rather recently.
Yeah, this is
Can you
exactly.
Give me like a succinct definition of astrological magic?
Sure. So astrological magic is essentially timing your requests of the universe to certain astrological or celestial phenomenon in the hopes or belief that your request or your ritual, however you want to conceptualize it, so that your request will be more effective. That's really it. Astrological magic is aligning your intention with astrological phenomenon to make it that much more powerful.
So really, that is just, as your book title, a prayer. But there are Absolutely. Other elements to it. There are Absolutely. People bring stones and oils and candles.
Yeah. Well, look, there are very specific traditions that are rooted in astrological magic. There are all kinds of ways that people do practice rituals to make those requests. I am a person who takes a very eclectic approach. So I believe that a part of what we are doing when we're practicing astrology or practicing astrological magic is we are forging a connection with the sky, but ultimately, because the sky is within us and we are the sky, we are forging a connection with ourselves. And so if Ooh. It is that, I mean, that's what I believe. Yeah. And so if it is that you want to actually have ritual and you want to bring your oils and your stones and things like that, there are correspondences and ways in which you can do that. For example, I'll give you one thing that we explore in the talk is the idea of Plotinus. So Plotinus was a Neoplatonist, which means he tapped into the ideas of Plato. And Plotinus said that you can gather all of your correspondences. So your correspondences are your stones, your oils, your incense. You can bring all of that together and you can gather them at the exact planetary hour. You can evoke and have correspondences related to the angel of that hour that you hope will help you in your petition or in your request. But until you speak the word, it has not manifested. And once you speak the word, it has already manifested. So it isn't just about gathering your oils and stuff, but what Plotinus believed is that the actual act of saying or speaking, putting the vibration out there, is what allows creation to happen. In fact, creation has already happened once it has manifested as sound. Once we do the ritual, once we say the word, we just have to show up for it. And so to me, that is prayer, right? That is what prayer is. Whether you want to think of it as, you know, in your heart, a silent prayer, vibrating with your intention, whether you want to think of it as actually speaking words, because my book, Prayers to the Sky, has prayers in it. Like it has prayers that are, some prayers come from the Homeric hymns, so they come from ancient Greece. And then there are some hymns, or rather prayers, that I wrote, that I utilize, that I use as an example, that this is the way that I pray. Yeah. And so there are different ways of understanding how you put your intention out there. To me, it's more important that people go on a journey to discover what it is that's going to feel fulfilling to them, personally to them, because I am very much of the belief that we each have a right to decide what a spiritual practice and what spiritual meaning is going to mean for each of us. It is highly personal. It is highly individual. And so I like to affirm that approach. That's what I affirm in the book. And that's why, at least for this class, we're going to focus on the history. We're going to focus on the philosophy, which isn't so much in my book, but I hope, will allow people to at least understand how they are going to approach the sky in their own practice of magic.
So if I'm hearing you correctly, this is an invitation to everyone to establish their line, their communication with the planetary energies. Do you work
Absolutely.
With stars or any of those things as well? Or you focus?
So personally, I love planetary magic. Like, that's sort of my forte. That's what I resonated with very early on. The planets as exemplifying archetypes or divine understandings, divine energies. But there are absolutely, there's signs, right? Some people like to use signs and they like to consider the sign, especially when you do lunar magic. You mm-hmm. want to consider the sign of the moon, for example. Some people like to use fixed stars and connect with the myths and the ancient understanding of the fixed stars. So it can be very personal. But I mm-hmm. hope that at least with this class, you feel like you're starting strong. You feel yeah. like you have the foundation. You're standing on strong ground. And from there, you can decide where you want to go next.
Yeah. Oh, wonderful. You know, there's a lot out there, but some of it feels a little exclusive. Like you have to have, you know what I mean?
Yeah, like, absolutely. Like you have
to know enough to do this, you know?
Yeah, or like you have to be like sort of initiated into a tradition.
Yes.
And yeah, and if that calls you,
or you know.
Yeah, look, if that calls you, awesome, go for it. But I was very influenced by a book called Pop Culture Magic. It was written by Elwood, if I remember it correctly. And in this book, it is in this book, Pop Culture Magic, that he talks about how when you see a character that resonates very strongly with a lot of people, that sort of hits a certain cultural point for a lot of us.
The zeitgeist.
The zeitgeist, thank you. That resonates with the zeitgeist. That is actually an ancient divine energy that is desiring to be known in a modern context. So that's his assertion.
Or is it something different?
Well, it's like a divine, you can think of it as an archetype, absolutely. But he conceptualizes it as a divine entity or divine energy. And I found this so intriguing. Sorry?
It has reappeared or that's always with us and we just notice from time to time.
I think it's like a modern interpretation of that. So yes, when you say it is an archetype, absolutely, right? We can think of it like, what is the Christ archetype? It is one of compassion. It is one of recognizing one's specialness, one's divine source and divine guidance. And that is something that we see again and again, right? The Christ archetype in literature, in movies, we see this again and again. I think about the work of Joseph Campbell, where he talks about the masks of God, and he makes these connections to mythologies around the world, how they continue. Or even think about this. Think about Mercury, right? The trickster archetype. We see this archetype show up again and again, and even in modern film, we see this show up again and again. Think about the Joker. This is an incredibly moving film, The Joker, with Joaquin Phoenix. When you watch this movie, you can understand why it is that he won the Oscar, rightfully so. It is such a brilliant way of understanding not only the trickster archetype, but going to the deeper layers, the depth, the underlying trauma that can be there that creates part of the mask that people wear. And so why has this role resonated with so many people? I think it's because we see ourselves, we recognize the divine in us through these different characters. And so I think that's part of what Elmwood was trying to assert. I think about, you know, being South Asian myself, and I'm thinking about how in some South Asian cultures, they put on plays. And even you can see this in, I know in the US, in the Christian world, where you will have the what is it called? The nativity, right? You'll have that play that's put on where someone is Joseph and someone is Mary, and you'll see that acted out. We see in South Asia the Hindu gods and goddesses plays put on where people are acting out these tales.
Embody
of their,
kind of,
yeah, yeah, exactly, right. We embody them. I think that when you look at the astrology chart, we are an embodiment of all those divine energies in our own unique way. And so when we do things like make prayer, when we do things like practice astrological magic, what are we doing other than evoking a sacred energy that is already within us? We're just bringing it forward.
Reflecting the sky.
Yeah, exactly.
I love it. I love it. I hope your talk just fills all the way up to the top.
Oh, thank you so much. I feel very blessed to be able to do what I do. I love astrological magic and that I can share this other part of myself, which I hadn't until like last year. It was last year that I really
I know.
I kept it very personal.
And we're friends.
I know, right? We're friends. We love each other. And still, but it feels really good to be able to share more of myself, more honestly, more fearlessly. And especially this, I just love the historical development. I love the ideas of Plato. We're going to be talking about Plato for sure quite a bit, because he was a deeply mystical figure. And we don't realize that, especially if you're just, you know, understanding Plato's ideas on a surface level, we don't realize that his ideas were rooted in a mystical understanding of the cosmos and the world around him. Yeah, so we'll be looking at Plato, we'll be looking at Plotinus, Iamblichus, we'll be looking at Ibn Arabi, Agrippa, yeah, the Picatrix, which is an incredibly important magical text of astrological magic. The subtitle to the Picatrix is The Goal of the Wise, or the Way of the Sage. That is how it's been translated. This is an incredibly important text, so we'll be looking at that as well as part of exploring how it is that astrological magic came to be understood and has continued to develop to this day.
Well, here's where I trust you, Nadiya, and where I must trust you, because I've read some Iamblichus and I ran screaming.
I love you.
I'm glad he's dead, personally, because that was nasty stuff.
Yeah,
I trust you because this is what you've done since I met you to be able to translate this for an audience that's beginning or that's just starting to look at this. And that's what I think your lecture will do, is open the door. As long as you finish being Iamblichus.
I'll be gentle, don't worry. I have a way of summarizing things, that's for sure.
I think you do.
Stuff, I mean, I remember even, I think about, you know, all those years I did academic writing and writing my my thesis. And it feels really good to be able to share these ideas that otherwise could be inaccessible because you have to like look up these words while you're reading it. Otherwise would be quite inaccessible. Yeah, right? A lot of them for sure. Yeah. But to be able to share the love behind the ideas, because I think ideas change the world. Ideas are a form of love that we get to put out in the world. And it just feels really good to be able to be part of that awakening in people that, wow, we stand on very broad shoulders as astrologers. There is such reverence that comes when we appreciate just how rich our tradition is, and that we as astrologers, we are part of a legacy. Like we have a legacy, we have our ancestors, our physical ancestors. But when you are an astrologer, all the astrologers that came before us, we are their legacy. They are our ancestors as well. And to realize that they thought deeply about what they were doing. They were not lightweights. They were people who cared deeply about this practice, and they had a deep philosophical conviction as to what they were doing. I think when you know that as an astrologer, you walk differently in the world. You understand what you do. You stand in the truth of what you do very differently when you understand on whose shoulders we stand, which are very broad, very strong shoulders.
Oh, Nadiya, I just can't wait. So your talk is Astrological Magic, an Introduction, and it's on November 7th. That's a long way away, at 10 p.m. to 11:30 p.m., and that is Eastern Standard Time. All the talks are Eastern Standard Time. And we really forward to this.
It is the perfect hour for me, 10 p.m. Eastern. I love it.
It's my favorite hour too.
I am going to be in my zone. Yeah, I'm going to have a lot of fun with that.
Well, thanks for joining us, and we can't wait to see you in November.
Thank you, Terry. I adore you. I'm so excited that you are doing this and that you're a part of this, and that it's given us a chance to just be with each other, be in the same energetic space. Like, that's everything to me. But also to be part of this amazing event, right? It is, it's going to be great. I'm sure of it.